Let's Talk podcast guests are invited to share their unique perspectives. The ideas expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the practices of Mesquite ISD and are not an endorsement of any particular agenda or viewpoint.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD's Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So let's have a real conversation about embracing our differences and finding common ground with our hosts, Dr. LaDonna Gulley and Ted Madden.
Hello and welcome to the Let's Talk podcast. It's episode 86 since we began this project in August 2020. We appreciate all of you who listen to our bi-weekly podcast, and you can get extra credit if you rate and review it and share it on social media. We're on all the podcast apps, and you can watch video of the podcast on our district YouTube page. And you may also contact us directly by using the email address letstalk@mesquiteisd.org. My name is Ted Madden. I'm a video producer for the district, and I'm a 49-year-old white man.
My name is Dr. LaDonna Gulley. I'm the Director over Leadership and Empowerment for our district, and I am a 53-year-old black woman.
And my name is Gilberto Prado. I am a 53-year-old Mexican-American who just joined the school district, so I'm super excited to be here.
Well, okay. We're going to ask you what your background is so we get a sense of your professional life and as much personal information as you want to share as well. But start by saying, when did you join the district?
Well, I actually started November 1st, right around that time frame. So I've been here about 5 months.
Okay.
Extremely excited. And hey, we're just taking it a day at a time and super excited to be here with you.
Can you give us your background, where you came from before this?
Certainly.
Other stops along the way?
Yeah. So, you know, I was brought to the United States when I was 9. You know, didn't know any word of English. Of course, I went through the education system in Dallas all the way up to 8th grade. I was then recruited over to St. Mark's School of Texas, private school, of course, for those of you that know, and went to college in Middlebury in Vermont. So experience-wise, in terms of education, I've had a wide variety of opportunities to learn. After I graduated, I really didn't know what I wanted to do. I actually wanted to be in investment banking. And I decided that while I was getting my licenses that I would, you know, stay in the restaurant business for a little while. And then I applied to several jobs after I didn't want to work in the restaurant business. I applied to Dallas ISD and two or three other financial firms, and they're all hire me. And so I was super excited about that. But I decided to work in Dallas as a purchasing buyer. I was like, well, you know, it's close by my house. And so it was supposed to be just kind of a transition year to figure out what I was going to do. And here I am 27 years later in the education business. Went through Dallas, worked for them for 20 years. I was recruited over to Garland, worked there 3.5 years. Then I went to Cedar Hill ISD as a CFO. Northwest ISD, and then Dr. Rivera just recruited me over to Mesquite, so I've been here for 5 months. But that's kind of my trajectory in terms of professional work, and I've been doing finance since 1995.
Wow, and so coming here to Mesquite, you know, what have you already found that you're like, wow, you know, this is really great?
You know, there's opportunities at every district I've been in. And one of the things that I always pride myself in the work that I do is obviously involving the whole team. And I think from a team perspective, Mesquite obviously has a very awesome a way of family treating individuals as a team, as a whole. But in every district I've been, I've always set it up and hopefully it's left it better than when I joined. Every role that I've taken, whoever was under me has taken the next leadership or taken my spot. So that's something that I'm pretty proud of. I hope that I can accomplish that as well here at Mesquite ISD.
I feel like you and I are similar in this way, is that we're both in education, but neither of us are actually educators.
Exactly.
You know, I'm a video producer, right? I will interview students once in a while, edit videos, but I'm not teaching.
Right.
So on a day-to-day basis, in your position, and I do want to ask about your position in a minute,
right.
What do you do to kind of remember that what I'm doing in my job is to helping students?
Yes. So I've always held that very close to my heart in terms of students. Of course, I have three boys. You know, educating three boys, going through the system, they all went through Garland ISD. That in itself brings in a lot of different perspectives on a daily basis of what the hard work that that school district staff does on a daily basis. I also volunteered. I used to do some recruiting for St. Mark's for some of the underprivileged kids. And I also participated in a charter group. I also served in a board capacity. So again, in terms of having an interest on student success has always been part of my DNA. There isn't everything I do, I hope, and I always talk about it, is that it's student-driven. Mm-hmm. All the decisions that we make should be based on that. Students come first in every aspect of what our role is. And if we're not doing that, then we should probably reconsider what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. So you said that you were brought here by Dr. Rivera. So please share, what did he say that really convinced you that, yeah, I think Mesquite ISD might be for me?
You know, I say he brought me, right? So it's a partnership, right? And it was an opportunity. Dr. Rivera and I have worked together at Garland ISD. And so we knew of each other. We knew of our work. And certainly, the conversations that took place before I got here were probably 2 or 3 years in the making. So it wasn't something that just happened. We had had conversations previously. As a matter of fact, I had applied to the Mesquite ISD about back in 2019, maybe 2020, and I did not get hired at that time. But, I never give up. Mm-hmm. That's when I'm another piece of mine. I'm very competitive, and I've always been in sports and whatnot. And so, when this opportunity came and we started the conversation again, it was kind of reignited. And I decided that this time probably I had a better shot. So I went through the interviewing process, and I just happened to, be part of MISD now.
So your job title is Assistant Superintendent, Finance and Operations. Your job sounds both incredibly important and incredibly boring.
Yeah.
How do you do it career days?
Man, I love this job. It's such a great niche, really. I had a couple of opportunities to talk to some college kids recently and talk about the opportunity that exists in finance within a school system. It's a little different, right? When you talk about finance, you talk about accounting, you talk about, investment banking, all the pretty little things that potentially you hear out and about. But school finance is a great opportunity for those financial type of mindsets. My role here is really to have the structure and systems in place so that we are in a very, very good standing financially for the district. That involves a lot of things. It involves, cutting checks for people on a daily basis, payroll, accounting for all those dollars, projecting what our revenue streams will be or look like. When we talk about finances, you're really talking about a $600-700 million organization. So those are huge dollars that come through the system. And we have to account for all that. We have to make sure that the resources are allocated, but specifically driven to academic success for our kids. So again, most of our dollars go to that. In terms of the operations side, facilities, of course, we need to keep them up and running. And it's a whole nother world, really, in terms of facilities and operations, in terms of buildings. People don't want to talk about the HVAC systems, heating, air conditioning, plumbing, all those great, awesome things, of course. But we have a great team in Mesquite that take care of that and kind of goes unnoticed, but they take care of our buildings and systems. In terms of food and child nutrition services, another area that I manage. Of course, we have to feed all our kids. And it's a major, major job to feed 30,000 plus kids on a daily basis. So again, huge responsibilities, but it's not me, it's the teams that are set in place to take care of every aspect of what I just talked about. I lead, but I can't lead without the teams that are set in place right now.
Can I ask you to put a finer point on something? When you said we've got to be accountable for all the dollars, I mean, you're talking legally accountable, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, that's the thing with the school district and taxpayer monies that I just want you to...
Absolutely. I mean, it is, we are so under the microscope, for obviously from federal and state, and then of course our, just, you know, our community. We are responsible for the dollars for our community. And so we have to be great stewards of every dollar that we generate. And we just want to make sure that it's going to the right places and account for it on a yearly basis. You know, we go through an audit and we usually find things, and we just build on those items that we find on a yearly basis.
Mm-hmm. There's always a lot of talk and discussion, just not only in community in general, but across our country, about public education and dollars. And so how do you help demystify some of the myths and the assumptions that are made about schools and school finances?
Well, I'll tell you that we have a very limited stream of resources. We are obviously, you know, funded on a per student basis. And it's usually around 6160 plus. You have other demographics that generate a little more funding. But we had to provide services to a wide range of kids. You know, when we talk about our bilingual population and other demographics. And we want to make sure that we provide those resources to adequately, you know, teach our kids. It's not an unlimited amount of resources. It's very, very limited. So we talk about our payroll probably. We're in the business of people. We talked about our students, right? But teachers, administrators. And when I say administrators, we're talking about campus staff as well. Mm-hmm. that run our buildings. But when you talk about every single dollar that comes into the district, we spend about 83% on payroll. 83 to 84%. And then when you start kind of breaking it down a little more, well, what do you do with the rest of the money, right? Well, we have to pay utilities. We have to maintain our buildings. And so, again, once you start looking at it from that lens, it becomes a little more apparent that what we have is definitely not enough. Mm-hmm. But what we do with it is, I've always been a big proponent of, what is it that we do with our dollars? We might generate more dollars, but if we're not doing it, allocating it appropriately to, again, what impacts students the most. And that should be our focus. And so, again, you know, it's just finance. When you talk about school finance, it's, you know, people think it's just numbers. It isn't. There's a lot of decisions that happen. And then, you know, we have to advise. My role in the district is to advise. Advise the superintendent, advise the board, and just keep them, you know, with all the new things that are coming up.
You said you moved here when you were 9 from Mexico.
Correct.
How has that shaped and kind of informed who you are today? Because you can help illuminate this, but just the idea of having a home where I've grown up and going somewhere completely different and not knowing the language and having to start over sounds really daunting.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy, actually. Now that I look at it, it's kind of fun. But, you know, I was immersed at that time when I came, which is 1979. School districts, specifically Dallas, just wouldn't take any kid that would come into the system. As a matter of fact, my brother never got the opportunity to study.
Can I ask about that? Because it's something we talk about. It's something that stuck in my mind when I did a story in 2008 with the Molina Athletic mm-hmm. Director, Charles DeVille. And he said to me, and I was in TV at the time, and he said, if a kid shows up, we got to teach him. I said, what? Mm-hmm. He said, no. I mean, any kid that shows up from, you know, our area,
correct,
straight from Mexico, wherever, our job is to teach him. When did that happen then?
Your brother couldn't? 1979, it wasn't happening.
Wow.
And so I got the opportunity to, I actually got demoted in quotation marks to third grade. It was mm-hmm. Dendy Rogers was the name of the school. We went there and I was supposed to be in fourth grade and my brother was supposed to be in sixth or whatever it was. And so I got the opportunity to study. I went down to James B. Bonham as a third grader. And I'm glad I did. I mean, it's great. They had a great bilingual program. The teacher there, I can't remember his name at this time, but I was in a bilingual setting, and everything we did was in Spanish, and we, you know, picked up a few words here and there, and went to Robert E. Lee for a fourth through sixth grade. Mm-hmm. I can tell you that by sixth grade, obviously, you know, I could defend myself in any form or fashion. And as I said, seventh and eighth grade to J.L. Long, and my high school was going to be Woodrow Wilson until some white guy came and recruited me from St. Mark's, and he just hounded me to death, and he actually became one of my best friends. And I did his eulogy when he passed away, Mr. Evans Mank. It's a great mentor to me. He was awesome. And anyways, I went to St. Mark's, and I went from straight A's to D's and F's and C's. And I figured I would stick it out for a year, but I ended up graduating from St. Mark's, and mm-hmm. it was a great experience as well.
When you're talking about that, though, that's actually a case that went to all the way to the Supreme Court, is Plyer versus Doe. And it's the 1982 decision. It was a case in the Supreme Court, and it struck down a state statute that denied funding for education of undocumented immigrants to the United States.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
So, 1982 Supreme Court case.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I just got lucky.
Who were we? I can't remember if it was us talking about it. There's so much stuff rattling around in this nearly 50-year-old brain. Whether it was us talking about the idea, I think it was one of the people we had in here talking about when she was at one side of DSD as a DISD. Substitute and seeing the resources they had going to another, and they had so much better resources.
That was Miss Jackson.
And then was it she also the one that said when she went to college, she wasn't ready?
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds like you going to St. Mark's that based on the education and the foundation you had, you just weren't ready.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, hopefully that's getting better.
I can tell you that it was a whole new world, obviously, for those of you that know St. Mark's School of Texas. I was, one of the handful, either Hispanic or African-American kids mm-hmm. in that system. And it was very difficult to integrate. One of the things that I do great, I've always done, is I am very competitive, and I will not let anyone tell me no or you can't do this. My attitude is whatever it takes, obviously within the legal realities that we have to deal with. But that was one way that I contributed to the system. You know, I was a great runner. I was a great soccer player. The things that I could do well. Academically, I can tell you that I just did enough to get by. And so I could have done a heck of a lot better. I chose not to. Coming from J.L. Long, going into St. Mark's, you could truly see the difference of the academics.
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt about it. It was more like going from a middle school into a college setting at St. Mark's. And so that, again, was very difficult to kind of integrate and adjust. By the second year, I told Evans again, Evans was my mentor. He was a teacher there. He was a social studies teacher, had been there since the 70s, loved St. Mark's, loved to recruit kids. And he had a system on how to do it. And I just kind of fell into that system, I guess. You know, some of the teachers would identify kids and then say, Evans, I got a kid here, Mr. Wonderful, that's what they call me. I don't know why. I don't feel like I am.
He's trying to give himself a nickname in Mesquite,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, right? That's exactly right. As a matter of fact, I alluded to that. He wrote a little story about me and sent it to me, and I used it in his eulogy. And again, Mr. Wonderful actually was from a teacher at J.L. Long, Miss Morgan. She was the math teacher. And so that's kind of how I landed there. He had a system all across the district, and he would use teachers to recruit kids. Hey, just send me the name. I'll do the work, and don't worry about it. And so, that's kind of where my path was.
Wow.
So how good of a soccer player were you?
I'm really freaking good.
I love it. And he's not modest. I like that too. What do we say? We don't have false modesty.
False modesty.
We don't do false modesty around here. So we encourage that.
No.
And I tell you, I mean, you know this, then if you're integrating to St. Mark's as you did, if you're good at sports, you integrate a lot faster.
That's exactly right. It did. It helped. You know, I was pretty fast too. You know, I probably ran about, I don't know, not as fast as some of the kids nowadays. I mean, they're breaking 4-minute miles, but. You know, I ran around a 4:24 in high school, so yeah, it was pretty competitive.
It's incredible.
Wow.
Did you win a school state title or anything with that?
No, we have a record somewhere with, I think it's the 4x8 still hasn't been beat yet.
Wow.
Hey.
That is impressive.
Right.
Right? That's very, very impressive. So, you've just arrived here a few months ago, and I just am wanting to know. I know you build great relationships because I have to say that I overheard them watching the World Cup, which is so awesome. And he was doing that with his staff that were there. Everybody was in there cheering and having a really good time. So how are you building relationships within your department?
Well, one of the things that you have to do, in my opinion, of course, is you build trust. You know, within the organization, your work speaks a lot, you know, whether you've already come with some of the knowledge and whatnot, but building relationships works both ways, right? And so we have to be able to give a little, take a little. And so, you know, I've never, while I was outside Mesquite ISD for 27 years, I never read anything negative or anything about Mesquite ISD, right? And so, and it's great. But then you come into a system and you start kind of analyzing, putting things together. And there's a lot of opportunities. So you have to show that to your team, different ways of doing things, perhaps. I lead, hopefully by example, but I lead in a very integrated, fun, you know, let's get our work done. We're here 8, 10, 12 hours a day together. And so I think that you have to be very flexible in terms of how you lead. And that in myself, I feel that I am. I'm also very consistent. You will always hear me say the same things, whomever I'm speaking with, whether it's superintendent or whether it's with you. I'm very consistent in the message that I send because that's our business, right?
I'm listening to you and I'm thinking about when you talk about just that flexibility and that pliancy, right? That is so critical. How do we teach that? I'm actually looking into that, into just teaching flexibility because we, you know, oftentimes I think as adults we can become somewhat rigid.
Yes.
And so it's really important that we remember not only the small things, but also just, you know, that we're human and we make mistakes.
You know, leading is hard enough, right?
Right.
let's not make it any harder. is kind of what I preach. As I mentioned earlier, in every role that I've taken the last, since Garland ISD, the person that was underneath me, I trained them to take my spot when I was in there. And that has happened in the last three districts. Even at Northwest ISD, where I was only there for 4.5 months. And I hope that I was able to help that district. And I think I did, because I have very positive comments. But the guy that was under me took the CFO job based on my recommendation, just 4.5 months into the system. So I think, you can make it quick, but sometimes it takes a little longer, and I'm okay with that. You know, I won't say that this is my last stop because you never know what's in the horizon, but I hope it is. I moved to the district. I feel like I am part of the community now fully. You know, and I can go vote for council and board members and all these things, and I can actually give the city some of, you know, what it takes for them to get better. No. but again, so I'm just integrating, learning a lot from my peers and so on. So
one thing that strikes me is kind of just your outgoing personality. When we first met, your personality doesn't match your job title. Okay. When I worked with George Reba, Channel 8, yes, for a lot of years, people who'd watched him for years and idolized it would meet him. And George is a goofy guy.
Right.
You know, and overly friendly, and he can't believe if someone wants to actually take a picture. You know, so you see the serious George Reba on TV. And there was another guy I remember meeting one time, Chris Myers, used to be on ESPN. We saw him out in California Cowboys camp. I'm like, this is Chris Myers. I watched him on SportsCenter,
right?
You know, in the early 90s. And he was like Reba. He's kind of this goofy guy. Couldn't, you know, seemed like he was more glad to meet me than I was to meet him, like that. I got that sense from you to some degree.
Yeah.
And it's showing that leadership can look a lot of different ways. Does your personality, has that ever, I don't want to say not matched with the leadership you try to do, how do you manage to be a leader when you've got to kind of make sure people are doing what they need to do with the kind of personality you exhibit?
You know, I like to think that I train leaders in every organization that I've been in. It's a big thing for me, and leadership can look different ways, right? I started when I was at Cedar Hill, and I learned this from Mike Miles up in Dallas. When he was there, he would come in and we would meet, and he would do little clips, movie clips, for whatever purpose that he wanted to kind of show for the cabinet. And then we would talk about the clip, you know, hey, well, what do you see from this thing? And so a few years later, when I went to Cedar Hill, I started doing the same thing. And so I would pick like movie clips that exemplify leadership and different styles of leadership, right? Not for me, but for the team to kind of look at it. You know, when it comes to the finances of the district, when it comes to certain things, there are very specific things that we need to take care of our business. I mean, there's no deviation from that. There's also opportunities where we can do things a little differently. And that comes out of that leadership mentality. I've had several experiences where people will tell you, oh, no, I can't do that. It's never been done. There's no way. And I'm like, there is a way. And I don't tell them the way. I just give them the specifics. There's definitely one way or a different way to accomplish this. And so I try to incorporate that into my leadership and not be so structured sometimes. I think we kind of get into the structure of leading and what is the definition of leading. Mm-hmm. I've read so many books about leadership, I don't think I remember anything from them.
Right.
But at the end of the day, you know, I had the lady that took my spot, and I'm kind of mentoring her at Garland ISD, mentioned to me the other day, is like, Gilbert, how in the heck do you do it? You know, you were only in Northwest ISD for 4.5 months, and all the people I've talked to about Northwest ISD just love you. And I'm like, I didn't do anything. You know, I just did what I normally do in any given day. And so she said, well, you ought to do a class on that, right? And I'm like, absolutely not, because I don't know. It changes every day. But I think, again, it goes back to the point of, hey, are you flexible? Are you having a great time doing your job? Mm-hmm. Are you here for a purpose? And the purpose is, yes, I am, and that is for our students. And if we're not here for that, then we might as well find another job.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Do you, when you think about your own values, and you think about how they align, when you think about, well, so why don't we do this? Talk about what are your values? What do you value? And how does that align with the school district?
You know, I always say we have to do things the right way all the time. And that's what I try to do every day. Now, have I every time done the right thing? Probably not. So I learn from my experiences. Part of my values is you have to do the right thing at every point, whether it's your family, whether it's work, whether it's whatever it is that you're involved in, always try to do the right thing 100% of the time. That has kind of driven me and help out in different ways. You know, I know that I'm fairly new to Mesquite, you know, the city of Mesquite, but I would love to, you know, contribute in different ways. And maybe that's in the future. But again, I would love to kind of do that as well.
Well, it's been fun getting to know you a little bit. Yes. Appreciate you coming in for this.
Absolutely. We already ran out of time?
Yes.
I know. I talk so much.
What else you got?
No, I thank you very much for having me. When you first mentioned it, I was like, I don't know what this is going to be like. And certainly, yeah, anytime, if there's a specific topic that you guys want to talk about or the opportunity to expand on a certain topic. You know, legislative session is going on right now, mm-hmm. right? That's mm-hmm. always a fun part for, not only for school districts, for finance. And so, you know, we keep track of that. And if there's anything that you need clarity on, I'm available as a resource anytime you wish.
Is there anything worth watching down there right now that you're keeping your eyes on?
There's a lot.
You know. Sure, there's a lot.
There's a lot. I've been in this business, like I said, for 27 plus years. And every 2 years, it almost seems like it's just a recurring issue. You know, big topics right now from the finance is, you know, property. Yes. How are they going to tax relief in that sense, and whether they're going to provide more resources to school districts. Again, those are big topics for us as we move forward into 23-24. In terms of finance, it is very tight. But I think the district's doing a really good job managing that.
Yeah.
That's Gilberto Prado with the most exciting job in the district. He's the Assistant Superintendent, Finance and Operations. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Time for our closing segment called Just a Moment. LaDonna earned her doctorate's degree in educational policy and leadership, so we like to allow her a moment to discuss a topic of her choice.
So you guys know that I'm all about dignity and belonging, but today I'm going to talk a little bit more about active empathy and what that looks like. It comes directly from out of the book by Donna Hitz, Leading with Empathy. And she is referring to a statement that Daniel Goleman made, who is a researcher, and his book is titled Social Intelligence, The New Science of Human Relationships. And what he says is that there is really a lot of gratification in experiencing and being experienced. And so what does that mean? It says that the research shows us that we are wired to connect. So that's a good thing to know, that we, mm-hmm. you know, that when we meet people, when we pass people, that we're automatically wired to connect. But it's really based on a couple of things when we talk very specifically about empathy. There are three ways that he defines empathy. It's the knowing, it's the feeling, and it's the acting for us. And so here, when I know that something has happened with you, right, then I'm going to automatically just say, oh, okay, like I really want to put myself in your shoes, right? But now I really want to feel. I need to also feel it. I need to say, oh, you know, that is, I feel how you might feel, right? Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to have some of the very similar actions that you have. And so it's all about me restating that I've noticed you, that I feel with you, and that I am also ready to help you. And so that's what active empathy is all about. It's all about noticing, feeling, and acting with you.
Are active empathy and radical empathy synonymous, or are they slightly different?
They are synonymous.
Okay.
Yeah, they're synonymous.
That's the phrase we use a lot.
Yes, we use radical empathy, but they are synonymous. And it's all about getting in there and not mm-hmm. only saying, oh, well, you know, I know how you feel. Or sometimes what we will do is say, oh, well, is that really bad? Like, you know, we'll kind of downplay someone, how someone else feels. Well, we don't want to do that. We want to yeah. really be radical about really getting in there and understanding and using those three techniques to really help people, to really help us really be able to identify more with that active empathy, that radical empathy.
So if you have any questions about this or about anything else for Dr. Gully or me, send us an email, letstalk@mesquiteisd.org. You can find us on social media using the search term LET, M-I-S-D. And please like, subscribe, and share the podcast. And if you listen on your podcast app, you can leave us a review as well. Thanks, as always, for listening. For Dr. LaDonna Gully, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next time.